Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all for being here. Secretary Geurts, I was really pleased to hear you say to Senator Hirono that you reaffirm the commitment to the shipyard infrastructure optimization plan. As you point out, the average age of our dry docks is 60 years old. You also acknowledge that the biggest shortfall we have is with our attack submarines. And as Senator King pointed out, and we all understand that the better job we do on maintenance means that we can have more ships at sea. So I was really surprised when projects from the Portsmouth Naval Shipyard showed up on the military construction list of projects to take money from for the president's border wall. And I was particularly surprised because I know you were at the Portsmouth Shipyard last fall. You were briefed on the projects which directly relate to our ability to expand the dry dock capacity there and allow us to, at the shipyard, to be able to do maintenance on more ships. So can you explain what the thinking is here, why we would take money from those projects that would back up our ability to address our backlog in submarine maintenance, attack submarine maintenance?
Yes, ma'am. So the list that was generated just based on those projects that met a certain set of criteria. That was not the list, as I understand it, of projects that were not to be funded. That will be a secondary process that the Secretary of Defense will work through. And I believe the commitments I have heard is the Secretary of the Navy will have an opportunity to provide his thinking in terms of readiness impact and all the other impacts should any of those projects be defunded. So the list itself was just a list to a certain set of criteria, particularly those that have not been funded yet in 19, as I understand it. But that is not a list of projects that were to be defunded, as I understand it.
But you would acknowledge that there's some uncertainty about that. And I can tell you, having visited the shipyard last Friday, that there's a great deal of uncertainty at the shipyard among the people who work there about what this means for their future. And I would argue that if we want to send a clear message about the importance of our attack submarines and our Navy and what is really critical to our national security, that we would not put those projects that are critical to maintaining our attack submarine fleet on that list of projects to be considered for defunding. So can you tell me what the Navy's response was when you were asked to list projects?
Yes, ma'am. Again, that list was created to a certain set of criteria, not the value or importance of each one of those projects. It was a set of have they been obligated yet? It was not a value judgment of the project. It was just a generic formula to a set of criteria the Secretary of Defense had put together. I will affirm the absolute criticality of maintaining our optimization plan. The Navy intends to put $21 billion towards that over the next 20 years. A lot of these near-term projects are absolutely critical, particularly in Portsmouth with dry docks, which are some of our oldest dry docks in the Navy, that we need to maintain those capabilities. And so I would be hopeful the folks in the shipyard don't take that as a signal of the lack of our commitment or lack of importance to that modernization.
Well, I think it sends a very mixed message. That is not a good message for the Navy, for the people who are so committed to ensuring that we have the ships that we need in the fleet, and for the country about what is important if we're going to maintain our national security. I would like to pick up on the question about our industrial base partners next, because one of the things that I've heard is that there's a lack of Virginia-class parts available in the national stock system and that the public shipyards are taking extraordinary measures to get parts, and that is often resulting in delays. Can you comment on that and what's the problem there and what we need to do to address it?
Yes, ma'am. So as we've gone to a 2 Virginia ship per year rate, as well as had more Virginia submarines in the fleet, we have had some parts that failed at different rates than we expected when we put the original supply system in there. Congress has been very helpful to fund in our kind of integrated enterprise plan, particularly parts that are common across our submarines and carriers, to allow us to invest in those suppliers, to get those suppliers up at rate. That's not only critical for today's operation, but as then we add Columbia on top of it, we've got to make sure the supply base is really ready to operate, not only to produce more, but sustain more that we have in the fleet. And we're continuing to work on that very closely. Appreciate the great support.
And so is that what it's going to take to make sure that we have the additional parts? Is it to make sure there's more funding or what?
No, ma'am. I mean, it's continued focus on it, continued looking at it. The other thing we're working closely with our supply base is allowing them to see the composite need between current construction, future construction, repair, and maintenance. That way they can size and they can understand the demand we'll be placing on them and make smart investments so that they're going to be ready as we continue to place more demand. This is a little bit of the, when we talk about supply base, you know, when we didn't build submarines for about 10 years, this shows in perfect, you know, clarity how long it takes to rebuild that base, how fragile it is, and how important the whole nation continues to focus on it. Because if you take your eyes off it or go on a bus cycle, it's really, really hard to get that back, particularly when you want to add new capability.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Blumenthal.